So welcome to the last day of our conference. So today is about tumors. Dorit Lillard 2 years ago, I think, told me it would be nice to do something like not only MSK or body or something, but like, you know, tumors and infection or emergency. We started with emergency. So we're doing something like that this time too, so about tumors. Our first lecturer is Professor Daniel Manen. I wanted him so much in Israel with us that we changed the date of the conference for him so that he could come.
It was Christmas.
So Daniel is French. He used to work in the main tumor hospital in Paris, Sylvie Gustave Roussy, for years. And then he moved to Bologna, to the Tumor Institute. And so in the MSK community, he's very, very famous, well known as, in my opinion, the best teacher in tumors in the world, you can say it.
Excellent.
And he's an amazing human being. So I'm so happy that Daniel can be with us. Thank you so much.
Okay, good. So let's start. You see here a very typical and nice view of Paris. And here you see my cousins, Marek and Sonia. They came to Israel in 48. They are 85 and 87, very active, bright, tonic, absolutely fantastic. 6 months ago, I told them that who would come in Israel now. They said, in 6 months, we will try our best to be still there. Yeah. And they are there. It's a magnificent video with you and with them. So, bone tumors. What is the role of imaging? And the first part is the diagnosis. You see, that is a bone tumor. You see here the bone tumor. How to make the diagnosis? Think a little of that. What is your diagnosis? And we play with that. We take a lot of points and we try to reach a reasonable probability. And it's very useful to understand that the pathologist does exactly the same. So the old idea that was the radiologist plays and anywhere the pathologist makes a diagnosis is not true at all. We do exactly the same job with different weapons. We have the whole lesion. The pathologist sees from closer a very small part of the lesion. And if the part that the pathologist sees is not the right one, makes a mistake. So we combine, we bargain, and we reach a reasonable probability. Let's play with this one. Someone wants to play? By the way, you saw the cases of the quiz before that. So this afternoon, at the end of the afternoon, you are going to play with the cases. So during each stop, watch the cases, and we will play with them later. Let's play with this one. Who wants to? So first, that's an adult. Let's see the clinical story. The patient knows the lesion for 30 years. He came because for his birthday, he received gloves. And of course, he had some problems to put the fingers inside. So we know it's a very slowly growing lesion. There for years, it's certainly benign. Then it is a finger. And we know that 90% of the tumors of the finger are chondromas. So that's very probably a non-chondroma. And we reach like that a very reasonable probability. In fact, everything started in 68 with this book from Mr. Ludwig, who was the first one to use a software and a computer to reach a diagnostic probability. Before Ludwig was a very classical technique. I saw that before, it looked similar, it was that, so it's probably the same thing. Very efficient when you are very good, impossible to reproduce, impossible to teach. But after Ludwig, it was not at all the same thing. We started to use always the same way of studying the lesion to reach a probability. And now, when you send the case to Ludwig, he analyzes in the same way, and puts in the software program and gets the probability of the unit. Osteosarcoma, 95%, uric sarcoma, 5%, and so on. So, and we work in the same way. For example, we use the age of the patient. If we think that the lesion is benign, is malignant for other criteria, if the patient is over 40, we know that it's going to be a metastasis or a myeloma, even if we don't do anything else. It's very efficient. Let's say from before 5 years, a malignant lesion of bone will be, at that point, you are supposed to assess it. Before 5 years, almost always a metastasis of neuroblastoma. Very high probability, and you don't need a biopsy to diagnose that, so it's useful. From 5 to 15, osteosarcoma, Ewing, and then over a bunch of things till the metastatic age. Location, there are some very good locations for the radiologists. For example, the posterior part of the vertebrae. You have, in young patients, 3 diagnoses. One lesion is big and calcified, which is this one. Okay, that's an osteoblastoma. Very useful to diagnose in advance, because if you do a biopsy, that's going to bleed a lot. So you need a embolization before the treatment. This one is very big and completely lytic. You see here the missing pedicle. That's an aneurysmal bone cyst. And this one is very small. On radiographs, you see just the sclerotic pedicle here and nothing else. And here on CT, you see the nidus of the osteoidosteum. Okay, that's a very easy location. Then we have another very good one, which is the epiphysis of long bones. There is one lesion before the closure of the epiphyseal plate, the chondroblastoma, and there is one lesion after the closure of the epiphyseal plate, giant cell tumor. Very easy. The radiologist is fantastic. Of course, there are some exceptions. It's just a probability. Then we use size. Size is very easy to use. If it is very small, it's usually benign. Very small means more or less than 6 centimeters of big diameter. When it is big, everything is possible. Of course, before being big, your osteosarcoma is small, but it grows so fast that statistically, when we discover it, it's usually big. Limitation, the lesion grows. If it is poorly limited, it invades very fast the trabeculae, so it's aggressive. If it is well limited, it grows very slowly, it's probably big. That's an American example. You see here your lesion, which is very, very well limited with some sclerosis. So there was enough time for normal bone to react and to build the sclerotic rim at the periphery of these non-ossified fibroids. I tell you that in the American case because we have the specimen of a non-ossified fibroma, but it's not because the Americans are completely stupid, just the patient had also glioma, died from the glioma, and so they got the specimen of the non-ossified fibroma. This one is very well limited. You can draw a line showing exactly where the lesion is, but there is no sclerosis. It grows a little faster. You see it's an epiphyseal lesion in an adult, so it's a giant tumor. And here you see the explanation. Here, there are no trabeculae. Here, you have the trabeculae. So the line is very clear and very sharp. Trabeculae here, no trabeculae here. There was enough time inside the tumor to destroy all the trabeculae. This one grows much faster. We don't know exactly where the limit is. And the explanation is here. When the tumor grows, some trabeculae are destroyed and some not yet. So the limitation is not sharp. Then we study the periosteal reactions. You know the periosteum is at the periphery of the bone, usually not visible. And in case of aggression, it calcifies. And according to the shape of the calcification, we can have an idea of how the tumor grows. When we have perpendicular periosteal bone formations, it's usually malignant. That's an osteosarcoma. Here we have some perpendicular here, some linear here. The periosteal reaction is broken, what is called the Codman's triangle. The lesion is very poorly limited, grows very fast. that you have sarcoma. And this case is interesting because it's quite poorly limited with multiple poles everywhere, but the periastinal reaction is very thick and regular. And even if there is a big mass in the sub tissue, that grows very probably slowly, and that was a stomatitis. Then we start to look at inside the tumor. This one is completely calcified, very dense. It's easy, right? It's a knee of a young child. In the metaphysis, it destroys the cortex, goes into the soft tissue. Here is a Codmat triangle. That is an osteosarcoma. That's simple. Look at this one. The main part of the lesion is lytic, but the small part here makes bone. So even if there is a biopsy here answering the fibrosarcoma, we know that the lesion makes bone, and that is the osteosarcoma. That is very typical of cartilage. Imagine the tumor made of multiple lobules of cartilage, calcified at the periphery with a clear center, what we see here, for example. So that is a cartilaginous tumor here. Done all that, we arrive to the leave me alone lesions. Very important job for the radiologist. Say that we know what it is, it's benign, we don't need anything else. That's the case, for example, of a non-ossifying fibroma, which is painless in the cortex, metaphysis, young child, and will disappear alone. And here you see it starts to re-ossify, and will re-ossify completely and disappear. 2% of the children in the street have something like that. This one is the proximal humerus, proximal femur in the metaphysis in the center of the bone, well limited. That is a simple bone cyst. If needed, you put a needle inside to remove a little of the water and it will disappear. This one is much, much more useful. It's always in the same location, which is the medial part of the posterior condyle in the knee, always there. It's usually painful, and you see radiologically that part of the cortex is missing, and there are some perpendicular periosteal bone reaction. It looks very aggressive. And it's painful. And if we do a biopsy, this lesion makes bone, and young bone. And for the pathologist, it looks like an osteosarcoma. But just because of the location, always there, we know that it is just an avulsion, and we just have to wait, and that's going to disappear spontaneously. What is the first thing you should do if you see something like that? That is a question to you. Question. What to do? You are here, the son of your partner has some knee pain, you do an x-ray, you see that. What to do immediately? You do immediately the other knee, because in half of the cases it's bilateral. And that is, okay, perfect. Which means that in half of the cases it's not bilateral, and you will have to wait. Just control after 3 weeks to check that it's not the stupid osteosarcoma starting in the same location. If it doesn't move, you wait. And this one is a piece of bone growing in the wrong direction. That's an osteochondroma, which means the cortex of the lesion is in continuity with the cortex of the normal bone. And here you have the cartilaginous cap and the erosion of the rib because it took years to erect. Okay. That is also a diagnosis for the radiologist. Pain, a lot of pain, young patient. Inflammatory reaction, normal initial x-rays. And after 3 weeks, you get that. See that here? You wait, and you see it starts to ossify at the periphery with a clear center. Ossifies more and more, and will integrate the bone and disappear alone. That is a myositis ossificans. And if a biopsy is made at the periphery, it shows young growing bone looking like an osteosarcoma. So that's for the radiologist, no biopsy, incredible. For example, flat bones, short bones, and here's the sacrum. There is a huge lesion of the sacrum, not so well visible. But we know it before the cortex, and this part of the cortex is missing. But on CT, half of the sacrum has disappeared in this lymphoma. So on those bones, we move almost directly to CT because it's too difficult for radiographers. We study very well dense bone. Here is a thick periosteal bone formation, nothing more visible. Biopsy, inflammatory bone, CT, and here you see very easily the nidus of the osteosteoma. So when the bone is very dense, we see very easily the inside. Cartilaginous calcification, this lesion is well limited with some sclerosis and calcifications inside. On radiographs, we know it's benign. On CT, we know it's made of cartilage. You see it's round with a clear center, popcorn pattern for breakfast. And that is a chondroma, we are sure, of the diabetes. The thickness of the cartilaginous cuff here, when it is more than 2 centimeters in an adult, it's very probably malignant. Here we see the cartilage, this one is very nice. And you see the lesion, which is round with a clear center, and here the thick, non-calcified cuff in this chondrocyte. Look at this one. Husband of someone working in your hospital, pain of the knee, sclerotic lesion, regular periosteal bone formation, just the beginning of CT. So up, you move to CT. And here we see very easily the perpendicular periosteal bone formation, indicating something malignant. And that was indeed an osteosarcoma. So even a long bone, sometimes we get something more from CT. Very useful sign. When you have tumor inside the bone, tumor outside the bone, and a normal cortex in between, it's an extremely aggressive lesion, growing very fast, so there was not enough time to destroy the cortex in the middle. So tumor on both sides, very probably malignant. Just the opposite. Here the cortex has completely disappeared. But at the periphery of the lesion, you have a calcified rim of periosteal reaction that grows very, very slowly. Enough time to destroy the cortex, remaining periosteal bone formation at the periphery in this simple bone cyst. The density was zero, allowing also the diagnosis of water and cysts. And sometimes we see those fluid levels up. Cavity is here. Cells at the lower part and fluid at the upper part, fluid levels, indicating usually slowly moving blood. Very often an aneurysmal bone cyst, but everything else with blood in the cavity can be the same sign. An MRI. For the diagnosis, the role of MRI is very limited because we study poorly the limitation. We don't see well the periosteal bone formation. We don't see the calcification. Look at this 16-year-old lady. That's a CT, that's the MR. On CT, we see the fracture, of course. We see the mass of the soft tissue. We see that it's ossified. We see the perpendicular periosteal bone formation. So malignant, makes bone, that's an osteosarcoma, which is broken. Now, that is the MR. We hardly see the fracture. We don't see well the ossification. We don't see the periosteal bone formation, but we see perfectly well where the lesion is. All the iliac bone crossing the sacrum, but the holes here are safe, and the roots are not involved. So it was still time for the surgeon to operate following the there and setting the roots, and we have 25 years of forward now for this lady who had 2 babies. Before, we see, we didn't know, would not have been possible. With MR, we know exactly where the lesion is. So the local evaluation is MR, certainly. General evaluation, bone scintigraphy, and chest CT. Staging, local staging, MRI, that's an osteosarcoma, which is broken with a cast. Is it possible to save the epiphyseal plate? MR, we know exactly where the lesion goes, so where the surgeon will have to cut the bone here. Here we see that this part is normal, but because of the fracture, there is an hematoma touching the epithelial plate that we cannot save. So perfect local evaluation. Skip metastasis, that's the main tumor. We see a small lesion separated from the main tumor, sometimes a little farther. So it's very useful to see that it's rare, but it indicates where to cut the lesion. We see also very nicely that the lesion crosses the epithelial plate, so there is no way to save the epithesis. Is it useful? Look at that. That's an osteosarcoma. Can we save the epithesis in this very young girl? That DMR. It goes to the epithelial plate. We decided that that was just a small fracture, stress fracture, and not tumor. See the same thing here. And that is what the surgeon did. Just at that level, and kept. So remove the tumor, save the epiphysis. That is the epiphysis of the patient. So save the joint. And here a double graft with a graft of the tibia from the bone, and here a vascularized fibula. So we are so close to know exactly what happens that we can use it at 2 or 3 millimeters. The main problem is the joint. For example, that is an osteosarcoma of the tibia invading the joint. That's easy, no problem. But when the lesion abuts on the cartilage, we are not able to know whether or not there is something inside the joint. And that changes completely the surgery. If we tell the surgeon that the joint is normal, he will cut here, and remove very little muscles. If we say that we have a doubt or the joint is involved, there will be an oblique resection of the whole joint, a lot of muscles and much more sequence. So we don't know. That is a real limitation. In fact, the surgeon opens the tooth, which is not fantastic, and we have no way to improve. Chest for pulmonary metastasis, what we have to know is that every time we see a nodule in a child, it's not always a metastasis. For example, if there is only one lesion, the probability for the lesion to be a metastasis is only 33%, which means if we have to change the treatment, we will need a biopsy of the lesion. So the best technique, but not completely relevant. Evaluation of chemotherapy, that is an osteosarcoma axial view of the femoral before, after chemotherapy. When the edema at the periphery disappears, it's a very good sign of effectiveness of treatment, but we don't know exactly what happens inside the lesion. Is this part viable? Is the other part viable? We don't know. It's why we do what we call dynamic study, clever name for something simple. We do an imaging and we repeat exactly the same thing, exactly the same with inside the time. And then we choose a part of the image or the computer does it, and we see exactly what happens in each pixel of the image. For example, that is an osteosarcoma before chemotherapy. That is a dynamic study. Every part taking a contrast medium very fast and very strongly is white. And we have a map of the active part of the tumor. After chemo, same size. And you see that the active part is now very reduced. And that takes 3 minutes on the computer. Some possible pitfalls. This patient has a fibrosarcoma. The idea of the treatment was chemotherapy, then resection here. That is after chemotherapy. You see that. There is now something in the epiphysis that was not there here, not very regular. And this part of the diaphysis that was normal is not any longer. Okay, it seems to grow. But in the same time, this thing has become smaller. How can we explain that? And it changes everything. If we decide that that is tumor, we cannot save the elbow. So it was decided that it was not tumor and to cut here. You see here, you can, here. What we have here is a tumor, and that is made of ions of red marrow induced by the growth factors, used in the same time as chemotherapy. And that may create a tough problem, and we don't have any clever way of solving it, because that takes a compost medium very strong, folks. also, and there are possible mistakes because of that.
Follow-up after treatment. You have to know that the main part of the prostheses are now made in titanium, which is non-paramagnetic, which means we can study the location with MRI. Not too many artifacts. Possible recurrence of an osteosarcoma here, CT, MR. You see almost no artifacts from the prostheses, big mass here, with fluid-free levels because full of lead, and that indicates easy to give a. So keep it. Still now, the main step to study bone tumor is radiograms. We start always with radiograms. The best way to make huge mistakes is start with MRI and try to diagnose. That's terrible. So we need something with X-rays to diagnose the lesion, or radiographs or CT, not directly MRI. The local staging is definitely MRI. We are extremely good. Except the involvement of the joint, we know exactly where the lesion is. The surgeon can cut very, very close without making mistakes. General evaluation, bone scintigraphy, chest CT, whole body CT if you want PET perhaps. We are just at the beginning of that. And local follow-up MRI, which is possible even after surgery in the majority of the cases. And that's all for bone tumors. Questions?